I wish she could be happy and find somebody that would make her happy. You know, I wish I could have made her happy.
She doesn't have hardly any friends. And she hates to move out and see people.
Where are those happy days? They seem so hard to find. I try to reach for you, but you...
Är du en lycklig person idag?
Det är inga lätta frågor du ställer.
For almost a decade, Agneta Fältskog was the biggest star in the biggest pop group on earth, ABBA. Sweden's pop perfectionists who topped the charts all over the world and sold almost 400 million records.
The unique quality of ABBA was that it's the purest pop that has ever been made.
ABBA's was the ultimate glam image, played out by two enviably blissful couples, Annefrid and Benny, Bjorn and Agneta, the sexiest woman in pop.
I'm sure Frida has long reconciled to this, but, you know, Agneta is without a doubt the icon in ABBA.
The first thing Agneta had was sex appeal. She was very sexy, and she didn't know it.
She had a great big Swedish butt that was constantly commented in foreign press, and we heard a lot about that in Sweden, too.
Incredible bump. She's amazing. She's all she was cracked up to be. Yeah, she was the beautiful blonde with the perfect bump.
But if you thought you knew the truth behind the happy faces and shiny songs, think again. This is the ABBA story that's never been told. The story of Agneta.
Since the day Agneta became a mother, I don't think that she enjoyed touring at all.
I think she had moments when she thought it was too big, you know, something physically with the whole size of it that frightened her.
You go out, then all of a sudden all of her insecurities and these fears that have been built up over the years would show. She wasn't happy because the lighting of the restaurant would be too bright and people might recognize her, and then just the opposite would happen, you know, that it would be too dark and she, you know, was afraid she wouldn't get noticed.
A beautiful icon for an entire era, she seemed to have it all, but then slipped into an increasingly reclusive nightmare of phobias, near-death experiences, family tragedy, and, as we reveal for the first time tonight, a more recent and truly shocking personal relationship.
We're forcibly, but you're from some of...
Can you imagine? Ever since I was a child, I was crazy about her. And now, here she was, sitting on my lap. It was a dream.
Today, Agneta lives in isolation on a remote farmhouse on the island of Ekerö, shunning public appearances and fueling speculation in the media. Last year, she broke her silence, giving her first TV interview for 17 years, seen here for the first time in Britain.
Jag försöker ha det väldigt tyst omkring mig den mån det går. Det är inte så lätt nu för tiden. Men jag blir lätt stressad. Och jag är en väldigt orolig person.
Agneta is quiet, doesn't want to talk to people, she don't see much people. I think she's been here most of her time after ABBA. She got a big house, lots of horses. Agneta is quite a lonely woman.
The isolation and the withdrawal of Agneta is due to fears.
Speculation over the reclusive singer reached fever pitch in 2000 when she unexpectedly resurfaced in court. Agneta was attempting to get a restraining order taken out on a stalker. But in the most shocking twist of all, It emerged this stalker had also become her lover, in a relationship which had lasted for 2 years.
I first heard about Gert about 3 years ago. I thought it was a nutcase. He was stalking Agneta and he really thought that they would get married. I think he's sick on the inside, really sick.
I would love to go back to Sweden, but the situation has to change. I wouldn't want to accidentally bump into Agneta again and be involved in another court case.
Gert van der Graaf had been charged with plaguing Agneta by telephone, following her in public and bombarding her with over 80 letters, and was found guilty on 10 counts of harassment. The judge said Gert showed signs of mental disability and had him deported back to his native Holland.
This is my house. I've decorated it in a Swedish style. It's a small bed. I wouldn't mind a wider one. I always have a picture of her nearby. I always want to be able to see a picture of her.
As well as a comprehensive memorabilia collection, Gert also has several letters he says he received from Agneta.
These are my letters from Agneta. I'd written her many more than she had written me. They often contain touching thoughts, private thoughts. This is a letter after our holiday together. Our love grows stronger and stronger. Your eyes, your warm hands, your soft embrace, your mouth. Thank you for a wonderful weekend.
Den här mannen som förföljde dig, är du utsatt för honom nu?
Jag vet inte om jag kan gå in och prata för mycket om det. Jag tror inte att jag gör det. För av säkerhetsskäl så kan jag inte göra det. Så vill jag ligga lite lågt där.
Är det här någonting som bekymrar dig?
Ja, det är det.
So how did Pop's one-time golden girl reach such a grim chapter in her bizarre life story? In part two, we trace the roots of those consuming fears and phobias which would lead Agneta into increasing isolation and a dangerously weird affair.
It started very tender, but became more passionate. Step by step. I think everyone knows what I mean.
ABBA and their music have touched millions of lives across the world. And for most, their true star was Agneta Fältskog. So what were the roots of the fears and phobias which transformed her from a blonde pop goddess into a recluse who had a 2-year relationship with a stalker?
I was Agneta's teacher when she was 13 and 14 years old. I gave her the opportunity to sing in front of the class, which inspired her and encouraged us.
We're on those happy days, they seem so hard to find. I try to reach for you, but you have closed your mind. Whatever happened to our love?
On April the 5th, 1950, Agneta Fältskog was born in the town of Jönköping. Situated on the shore of Sweden's second largest lake, Jönköping's original claim to fame was its preeminence in the field of safety match manufacture.
How can I carry on?
studenter så ofta som man har.
I've never had such a good student as Agneta in my class, let alone a student who went on to be as successful as she is.
A precocious singer, pianist and composer, Agneta didn't hang around. Just 12 months after leaving school, she attended her first recording session in Stockholm.
Jag tänker på att det var den första plattan jag gjorde. Och hur fruktansvärt nervös jag var när jag skulle spela in den. För att jag var ju bara 17 år och hade aldrig varit uppe i Stockholm, så att jag tog med min pappa skulle hålla handen. Så när vi kom dit, jag kommer ihåg, jag gick ner en trappa så här. Ungefär som jag känner mig nu. Ja, så hörde jag att de la på stråkar. Och då hörde jag, gud alltså, det är min låt. Jag fattar inte att det var sant.
The teenage Agneta went on to release a string of self-penned hits. But she was already uncomfortable with her growing fame and battling her natural shyness.
Well, the first time I met Agneta was in the record company. I was quite amazed about her voice. She had a clear, nice voice. I thought she had a good chance to survive the business if she could manage to overcome this shyness.
In 1969, while shooting this TV pop special, Agneta met the captain of her heart, 23-year-old Swedish pop star Björn Ulvaeus. The couple were immediately crowned the prince and princess of Swedish pop.
Agneta, I think she likes to open herself to anyone she meets. She has a complete blank loving kindness about her. And she starts out with love and warmth, and everyone is nice, and everyone is. But of course, in this world, everyone is not nice.
Enter the Swedish press, who landed predictably good copy when Agneta spoke openly of her vulnerabilities and life with Björn.
She wrote a love letter to Björn that the press had asked her to write. She didn't stop when it was getting too personal. And she was talking about what I today would say depressions. She said, well, life can be very tough on me sometimes, and what I like about Björn is that he's never trying to force me to be happy, to go out and be, but he lets me stay in the darkness until I'm ready to come out again.
In 1971, Agneta and Björn were married, and by now they'd hooked up with another musical couple.
Well, Anna, that's nickname for Agneta. She's married to me, and she's the blonde one. And Frida, the red-haired one, she's engaged to Benny.
There are kind of three marriages going on, Benny and Frida and Björn and Agneta, but the kind of real strong marriage, and the one that's still going strong, is the one between Björn and Benny.
Men vi har en fjärdedel utav ABBA, vi har nämligen Agneta Fältskog!
There was in ABBA a third extremely talented songwriter. There was Björn and there was Benny, but there was also Agneta. And Agneta proved already when she was young in the 1960s that she was an extremely talented songwriter.
Jag sjöng mina sånger i parkerna och någon enstaka krog någon kväll. Som jag gjort alla år sedan mitt namn stod på topp, men det har de redan glömt.
By joining ABBA, Agneta had the most to lose because her career was going very well at ABBA's inception. And she was a known quantity as a songwriter. But obviously, eventually, as a songwriter, she couldn't compete with Benny and Björn.
Agneta's solo career finally ground to a halt as ABBA took their first steps onto the world stage.
And we move now across into Sweden, the largest of the Scandinavian countries. And although we're looking at streets, it's a country full of mountains, lakes and forests. And of course, it's full of blonde Vikings. And this is one of the reasons why it's good for pictures. These are the ABBA group.
With Agneta as prime focal attraction, ABBA were already ruling Sweden under an iron fist of pop. when in 1974 they ripped a hole in the very fabric of space and time.
Oh, and it's Napoleon! Napoleon, no wonder their song is called Waterloo by ABBA for Sweden. Watch this one.
The first time I saw Agneta was during the broadcast of the Eurovision Song Contest in Brighton with Waterloo. She left an impression on me. She was a very beautiful woman. I was completely fixated on Agneta. She was my ideal of what a woman should look like. If I had found a girlfriend as beautiful as Agneta, or even more beautiful, I would have dropped Agneta. But obviously, that never happened.
Dan laat ik Agneta vallen, maar het is nooit gebeurd.
Did you change your mind?
Did you change
on the 13th night? On the up to three? Did you chance on me? If you need me, let me know. Gonna be around. If you got your place to go, when you feel down.
By the late 70s, ABBA had become the biggest pop sensation since the Beatles, with chart-topping hits and sell-out tours across the globe. Multi-platinum blonde Agneta was now an international sex symbol and increasingly the focus of media attention.
I read somewhere where you are the proud owner of an award which declares you as the lady with the most sexiest bottom.
I answer to that. I don't know. I haven't seen it.
I don't think Agneta was ever aware of the fact that she was sexually very attractive. She had a great big Swedish butt.
Incredible bum. She's amazing. She's all she was cracked up to be. Yeah, she was the beautiful blonde with the perfect bum.
Yeah, that's the first thing I noticed. And she had a little complex about that, you know. She was always hiding it. And I said, no, that's what you must take out. That's the beauty of the whole of Agneta.
With simultaneous number one hits in 15 countries, the cliches became reality. ABBA were Sweden's biggest export, literally earning more money than Volvo. But the very scale of this staggering success was unnerving Agneta.
Chiquitita, tell me what's wrong. You're ashamed by your own sorrow.
From the very start, Agneta had struggled to combine a meteoric pop career with her commitment to motherhood. She and Björn already had a daughter, born during ABBA's first year together. And in 1977, at the height of the band's success, she gave birth to a son. But the strain of juggling parental duties with ABBA's grueling schedule was taking its toll on Agneta.
Since the day Agneta became a mother, I don't think that she enjoyed touring at all.
She is very much a mother. And I know that Agneta all the time was talking about her children and felt really bad about being away from them. And there you are in the hotel room, knowing your children is, someone is tucking them to bed back home.
So the walls came tumbling down.
There was quite a crucial moment in her marriage to Björn, shortly after one of her children had been born, and she didn't want to go and do at all, and she was persuaded to do it anyway, and I think that affected her quite deeply.
She was a bit of a quiet one.
When Agneta didn't take part in any of the interviews or didn't actually have any input, there would be a strain, and that eventually started to show. Either afterwards, there would be a few long faces, either from us.
It did look
but
a lot.
But Anna Frieda, sometimes you can see that was a strain because she was kind of carrying it for the girls on that side of it.
Agneta's anxieties were worsened by the huge crowds ABBA now attracted wherever they went, and which caused her overpowering feelings of fear and imprisonment.
The first tours were quite small scale, but then it grew bigger and bigger, and Agneta was less and less comfortable with the size. I think she had moments when she thought it was too big, you know, something physically with the whole size of it that frightened her.
Some places we couldn't even go outside the door. People were waiting, you know, for us to hit us and, you know, or love us to death.
Her problems with ABBA's jet-set lifestyle were further compounded by a deep-seated and, as it turned out, completely justifiable fear of flying.
Do you like travelling?
Car, yes.
But what about that helicopter? Were you nervous?
I was. I don't like it.
It's very shaky about flying.
Yeah.
Ja, jag är fortfarande flygrädd. Utan det är just osäkerheten i mig själv när jag väl sitter där. Att jag inte kan göra någonting åt det.
We had played New York and we had a back-to-back to Boston. We had to go to Boston and circle the area because there was a storm settling over Boston. And the pilot had to throw the plane up in the air again because a hurricane just wiped out the airport. We were tossed around upside down, inside out, like a leaf, you know. Terrible.
When we finally landed, everyone was quite pale, and Agneta wasn't too happy, of course, since she is afraid of flying before this, and I guess it got even worse after this.
Her inability to fly meant touring was now impossible, and this was indeed to be ABBA's final tour. But returning home was to be just as stressful for the increasingly insecure Agneta as the band faced a counter-ABBA insurgency in Sweden.
In Sweden at the time, there was this so-called prog movement, which was progressive music, which was a left-wing movement.
På flera håll i landet hade Alternativ Festival ordnat demonstrationer mot sina ännu så länge mer etablerade kollegors aktiviteter.
And they were against anything that had with money making and record industry and songs about love, happiness, joy, fun. That was just shit.
Och här kommer ABBA i kläder och plast, lika döda som cellkonserver. De skiter också i allt, vi gör snabba stol, vi pyr i mina franska nerver.
ABBA was everything that they were not. This was escape music, not political music.
Money, 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 always Sunday in the rich man's world.
The media situation was that they followed this prog movement only. So everything, every record that ABBA put out was immediately crushed.
Det är dyra vanliga människor som jobbar med någonting som vi har haft turen och lyckan att lyckas i, som vi dessutom tycker så vansinnigt mycket om.
Och vi har känslor och vi blir sårade om vi blir påhoppade varenda gång och det bara blir snack om pengar. För vi är stolta över det vi presterar. Och det är det som vi vill ska komma fram. Och det är det vi vill prata om. Inte pengar.
It was a shame. You didn't confess to liking ABBA until you were drunk or had a party or something. But it was... Well, you were hiding the record behind your...
I collected everything from ABBA, all the CDs, everything. I think I have everything they've done. As time went by, I just focused on Agneta and her solo career, from before ABBA and after ABBA.
A great deal of my life has been dedicated to Agneta. After many years, I decided to go to Sweden and try to meet her in the flesh, as it were. As ABBA continued their inexorable rise, Agneta's increasingly fragile emotional state would be pushed yet further. She would go through a painful divorce from her husband and her band, endure a near-fatal accident and profound personal tragedy, emerging more vulnerable and alone than ever before. In the late 70s, ABBA's perfect pop template of slick harmonies, killer hook lines, and effortless Nordic glamour earned its four members vast personal fortunes and a devoted global following. For those fans, the shining star of the quartet was Agneta Fältskog, the ultimate blonde sex symbol and perfect pop ice maiden. Even now, fans stake out her remote home on a regular basis, but Agneta's relationship with her army of admirers has become tainted.
For 10 years ago, I used to go to where she was living, Ikaro, and stand then outside in snow and cold. And then we wait till she showed up, and every time when a car came up, and, oh, she's coming, she's coming, and everything got out.
It's amazing the range of type of fans there are. This, the kind that just stay home and buy the records and never go to concerts or anything. I guess we're somewhat a little crazy because we travel around the world to meet other people, but I think we do it more to meet other fans than to chase or stalk the entertainer. But in those travels, you meet some people and you wonder, what are they thinking? What are they doing?
Gert van der Graaf had been a fan of Agneta's from the age of 8. By his early 30s, he had become completely obsessed.
Ik begon dus ook wel brieven te schrijven naar Agneta. Op een gegeven moment dacht ik van nou.
I started writing letters to her in very bad English. I sent them to Agneta, Sweden, as I didn't know her address. The first time I went to Sweden was in my little car. I was going on holiday, not only to find Agneta, but also to travel and learn about Sweden.
Nog niet echt op Agneta, maar toch wel weten hoe het land eruit ziet.
When I found out where she lived, I started writing to her at her address. I told her that I'd written hundreds of times before and never got a reply. Maybe she never got my letters. I told her I would be in my car, waiting, maybe at this time or at that time. So I had to wait there all the time. Imagine if she came looking for me and I wasn't there. After watching for a while, there was some movement from her house. Someone would come outside and pick up a newspaper, but she wouldn't come over to me. I guess she was probably checking things out, asking herself, who is this guy? You know, interested, but not acting upon it.
Toch wel geïnteresseerd zijn, maar niet echt.
I found this little house that was close, around 800 meters from her place. The price was okay, couldn't get better than that.
We are at Gert's old house. This is a couple of hundred meters from Agneta's place. Straight over the wood, the forest. Basically, some of the houses don't have running water during winter times, only on the summer times. It's a primitive existence.
1978, ABBA were still topping the charts, but Agneta and Björn's marriage was beginning to crumble.
Initially, Björn's line on knowing me, knowing you, was that it wasn't autobiographical, but it seems to me that maybe he had an inkling that this marriage wasn't going to be quite as idyllic as he initially kind of hoped it would be.
It was less fun than in the beginning. Now it was perfection, and it was there was a demand for them, you know, and they had to. So there was a tension. It wasn't that enjoyable anymore. And then came the divorces and all this. And
I think it's hard to work as a couple on stage. I think it's so hard to be so well known, and to be, it's like being in jail, I think. You know, you have to sleep on the same hotel room, you have to work together, be together 24 hours day. I think that's hard.
Vi skildes under tiden, Björn och jag, som vi höll på med ABBA, och fortsatte även efteråt. Så att, och då hade vi de, våra små barn som var bara 5 och 1 år. Så att jag hade ju hela tiden att dras med det här dåliga samvetet då, att de var hemma och så. Och det var ju ganska tungt och ändå presterade vi gjorde. Så att det var...
Agneta and Björn were divorced in 1979, but ABBA continued to record and sell multi-platinum hits, forcing Agneta to work with her estranged husband.
ABBA went on a lot longer than she wanted it to go on. And to put a stop to that, you know, I'm not exactly sure whose idea that was, but I think she was very happy about that. I think Agneta had some, has a lot of issues with Björn still. And I didn't ask. I don't really want to know, you know, just, but there weren't any fond words from her about him.
I don't want to talk about things we've gone through.
Winner Takes It All is such an astonishing kind of song to present to your wife. He's actually getting her to sing, "Well, tell me, does she kiss like I used to kiss you? Does it feel the same when she calls your name?" I mean, that's... I can't think of many greater acts of pop saving.
But tell me, does she kiss like I used to kiss you? Does it feel the same when she calls your name?
By the early 80s, ABBA's stranglehold on the top 10 finally came to an end. And so effectively did ABBA, although no one would actually admit it.
Every time we have a Swede on breakfast time, absolutely smashing. Despite all the rumours that ABBA is breaking up, ABBA goes on, yeah?
ABBA goes on. ABBA is resting for the moment. The boys are writing material for a musical.
That's with Tim Rice, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And Frida's working for herself and I'm working for myself, but we still try to keep the group together.
Already terrified of flying and becoming increasingly reclusive, Agneta was forced to travel to promote her solo career. She chose to go by coach, but another on-tour brush with death would force her to withdraw even more.
We came up late at night through Sweden. It was cold and rainy and very dark, and the roads were slippery. Suddenly, there was a red light, and he put on the brakes. And the whole coach turned around and fell over, and Agneta was thrown out of the window. Everybody said it was a miracle that we could survive such a crash. And she didn't dare to drive after that, and she didn't want to travel. She doesn't travel. She doesn't ever move around.
The next next year, 1984, Agneta suffered another blow, as Bjorn moved to England and Agneta was left with sole custody of their children. Agneta isolated herself in a farmhouse surrounded by acres of land on an island outside Stockholm. After her divorce from Bjorn, Agneta was constantly in the press, as she had a string of short-lived relationships with a wide cross-section of Swedish society, including an ice hockey player, her bodyguard, and her analyst. In 1987, she started seeing American record producer Bruce Gage.
At home, she was just a sweetheart, you know, and was a great cook and a fun person to be with, you know. And you go out, then all of a sudden, all of her insecurities and what's the word, fears. I mean, her these fears that have been built up over the years would show, you know. She wasn't happy because the lighting of the restaurant would be too bright and people might recognize her, and then just the opposite would happen, you know, that it would be too dark and she, you know, was afraid she wouldn't get noticed. I didn't want to be Mr. Fältskog. I know that if I had gone there, it would have been her career that I was working on, probably to exclude anything else, because she was jealous of anything else.
What is happening with her, I think, is that she does get bored. She's out to get the passion and the spark out of the first love. And when that is over, she moves on to somebody else.
By the late 80s, Agneta had begun what was to be a 17-year withdrawal from public life. As she appeared less and less frequently in public, the media began to latch on to her obsession with privacy and solitude.
Av en bild på en människa så tror man till slut så. Om mig har det stått till exempel att jag har stängt mig in eller isolerat mig ute på Ekerö, vilket jag inte alls har gjort, utan det har man liksom skapat den bilden då att jag har stängt in mig där för att jag inte syns så himla ofta. Och det är ju inte alls så det är.
In 1990, Agneta married surgeon Thomas Sonnenfeld. They were divorced within 3 years. But far worse was to come for Agneta. In 1994, her mother died in a tragic fall from her sixth-story window. It has more recently been reported as suicide. Her father died just 1 year later.
She was naturally, deeply, deeply shaken. It was a horrible time for her. I don't know how she or anybody could stand such a thing. It was too much, really.
I was working long hours and was very tired. And that's when I had a car crash. When I was recovering, I wrote her a letter about what had happened. I heard a knock, knock, knock on the front door. It was her, standing at my front door with her friend. I looked Agneta straight in the eye. It was my boyhood dream come true. Agneta, hello. Fortunately, because of the letter writing, we knew how to communicate with each other. So I knew exactly what to say. I invited them in for coffee. Her friend was chatting a lot, asking questions and so on. But she might as well have been in the other room. I was just concentrating on Agneta.
The first curse was al the first avond, zeg maar.
Our first kiss was on that first evening. But there was much more to it than that.
Yeah, for my first...
Yes, Agneta, she was my first. I've had girlfriends before, but never any sexual relationships. I thought she really enjoyed it. Afterwards, when we were recovering next to each other, we did remark on how it was possible that we had found ourselves in this position.
I hope you're enjoying this Greg GNP upload here to YouTube. Don't forget, please subscribe and like for more videos just like this.
Agneta Fältskog had lived in the spotlight since she was a teenager. But fame had intensified her fears and insecurities, and her private life had been cursed with misfortunes. For a 17-year period after ABBA, the troubled star withdrew from public life.
She wants to be left alone. You know, I want to be alone. It's true.
And she hides now that she's called the Great Agarbo and the mysterious Agneta. She don't want to play the game, because it's a game. This business is a game.
For the first time in 23 years, all four members of ABBA were finally seen together in public at the recent Swedish premiere of Mamma Mia. Agneta, always missing from the post-ABBA picture, had decided to re-emerge tentatively into the public eye.
Men du, det här snacket om garb och allt det där då, det gillar du inte heller, förstår jag?
Nej, det har ju inte kommit från mig. Utan det är ju återigen någonting som media har skapat då. För att, ja, varför man gör det, det vet jag inte. Men det är väl som ett straff då för att jag inte har visat mig tillräckligt ofta.
In 1997, Gert van der Graaf moved from Holland to Sweden to become Agneta's neighbor. Within a year, he had become her lover. The relationship lasted for 2 years before Agneta finished with Gert.
2 years? That's a long time. And it's a mystery to everybody how she could have stayed with this man.
I couldn't understand it, not then and not now. I never really understood why we broke up. So I decided, despite all the security around her home, to go up to her house. I rang the doorbell, looked her in the face, and I said that I wanted to talk to her. Without opening the door, she shouted, "I want you to leave."
Miss Fältskog made a report to the police where she told us that she was harassed by Mr. van der Graaf, and it was both by visiting, by sending letters, and by phone calls.
Gert continued to phone, send letters, and follow Agneta. In 2000, he was arrested and taken to court, charged with harassment.
When Mr. van der Graaf was arrested, he first was found at home, and two police officers brought him into the police station. Meanwhile, there were other officers searching through the cottage where he had lived.
Emerging details of the case sparked a tabloid feeding frenzy. Reports even implied the police had found a bucket of Agneta's feces in Gert's house.
It wasn't a toilet with running water. It was a sort of bucket into which he would throw some grains. I certainly wasn't saving Agneta's waste.
Nothing in the investigation showed that it was Mrs. Fältskog's poo. I just think he can't keep his home in order, I think that was the biggest problem.
I told him, why did you do it? And he answered me, because I want to live with Agneta Fältskog. I love her. I have loved her from I was 8 years old, and then I followed her all my life, and I want to live with her.
Miss Fältskog might be a very lonely person. She's a shy person. I got the feeling that she didn't know that Mr. Van de Graaff was actually what I would say sick.
Van de Graaff, describe their relationship as Romeo and Julia, but in the investigation Agneta Fältskog talk about Dr. Hyde and Mr. Jekyll.
Gert was convicted on 10 counts of harassment and deported from Sweden. 2 years later, in 2003, the terms of the judgment had expired and Gert returned to Sweden, where he resumed his attempts to contact Agneta.
Standing on this parking place, when we saw him, so I blocked the road here and called the police. And I went outside the car, tried to talk to him, and he ran me over. I was back into my car again, and I was chasing him. I blocked Gert's passes, I went out in the car, and I pulled Gert out of the car, and I punched him, and held him there until the police arrived.
After a final court hearing, this time without Agneta, Gert was again deported.
Mr. Van de Graaff, he's not allowed to contact Miss Fältskog in any way, neither by seeing her letters or phone. If he take any contact with Agneta, then I think he will be sent away for prison.
Den här mannen som förföljde dig, är utsatt för honom nu?
Jag vet inte om jag kan gå in och prata för mycket om det. Jag tror inte att jag gör det. För av säkerhetsskäl så kan jag inte göra det. Så vill jag ligga lite lågt där.
Är det här någonting som bekymrar dig?
Ja, det är det. Det är det. Men det är ju så, man har varit med så här länge också, så blir man ganska luttrad i olika situationer.
The kiss that I used to kiss you, does it feel the same when she calls
my toekomst afhangen van
my future depends on what happens when my deportation order from Sweden expires and when the ban on contacting Agneta ends. I would drop everything for her. I've done it before.
Beter manier moeten invullen, zeg maar.